The Colbert is a tier 10 French light cruiser, is the absolute definition of a glass cannon. She's certainly got a lot of ups and downs, and her skill floor may be higher than Snoop Dogg on the 20th of April, but in the time that I had her, she quickly became one of my all-time favourite ships, and I'm so excited to tell you all why. Colbert was constructed as an anti-aircraft cruiser for the French Navy in the 1950s, which explains her absolutely bonkers armament of 116, that will be bonkers.
My source is that I made it the fuck up.
16 dual-purpose 127mm gun. That's hard to say. 127mm guns with an unconventional arrangement, let's say. Despite her real-life purpose as an anti-aircraft cruiser, in-game her AA suite is actually pretty average.
The numbers, basically. What do they mean?
However, as a high-tier light cruiser, her DPM must be pretty sweet. Zombie Jesus, what is that? Her HE DPM absolutely dwarfs the closest ship to her, being almost double that of Smolensk in second place. And her AP DPM just holds off Edgar to ensure her status as the absolute champion of DPM in World of Warships. Now, you may think that applying this incredulous DPM is a challenging feat, and yes, but maybe not for the reason you first think of. Her gun handling and turret rotation is actually very impressive, whilst her shells have relatively good arcs. Whilst there are no railguns, this is actually a good thing, as her gun arcs let you utilise a wide variety of island cover while still being manageable to aim at longer ranges. Her ability to use islands is very important, and we'll discuss this in more detail later. The performance of her shells when they hit is incredibly impressive as well. Her DPM certainly isn't just for show. Colbert's impressive fire chance of 7%, coupled with her ridiculous rate of fire, makes her the best fire starter in the game, which is good as her HE penetration is not good enough to penetrate anything but the superstructure on most of the battleships and cruisers that she's likely to face. Don't fret though, as Colbert's AP performance is more than good enough to rip apart any cruiser showing broadside at close to medium ranges, and even allows her to keep sustained damage up on battleships far away enough to allow her AP shells to plunge onto their decks. If you're familiar with French destroyer Marceau, you already know Colbert's share perform- If you're familiar with French destroyer Marceau, you already know Colbert's share performance. If you're Why can't I say this line? If you're familiar with French destroyer Marceau, you already know Colbert's shell performance. Colbert? What is Colbert? It's not a cow! Colbert has identical shell performance to Marceau, okay? There we go. That's not so hard to say, is it?
You idiot. You're honestly an idiot. I don't know what's wrong with you.
Okay, well, actually, not exactly identical. Marceau actually has nerfed gun arcs to make her shells more difficult to aim at longer ranges. But apart from that, all other aspects of these two ships' gun performance are identical. If you're comfortable with Marceau's guns, you'll love Colbert's firepower. The upsides don't stop coming here, however, as Colbert also has access to the typical French high-tier cruiser engine boost, augmenting her mediocre top speed of 33 knots by 20% for 3 minutes before modification. This gives her an added degree of flexibility and allows her to move around the map and get into and out of positions with more freedom. She's also exceptionally maneuverable, with by far the best turning radius of any tier 10 cruiser, and her concealment is very respectable too, one of the best amongst tier 10 cruisers also. All of these factors enable her captains to be flexible with their positioning, and this is important because here comes the catch that we all knew was coming. Her armour is worse than non-existent, and let me explain. Some ships, like Smolensk, have such thin armour and are so narrow that most high caliber rounds will just entirely overpen through her citadel and pass out the other side, leaving her relatively unscathed with overpen damage. Colbert's armor, on the other hand, is just thick enough to ensure any high caliber rounds will fuse and deal crippling citadel hits to her, whilst not being thick enough to stop literally anything. I'm not joking, all her plating is good for is for shattering some HE rounds, and I mean literally just from destroyers and some light cruisers. And yes, technically her belt armor is thick enough to bounce even Yamato rounds, but if you think that's a good idea to rely on for survivability, then I have a clock to sell you. She's also got one of the lowest hit point totals of any tier 10 cruiser, and unlike Jinan, she doesn't have a smokescreen to hide in. This is why I said before that her ability to lob shells over islands is very important. If you don't have some form of cover between yourself and the enemy, you're going to become French toast. At least she has an improved heal, I guess. It heals more standard penetration damage than usual, and a whopping 50% of all citadel damage on top of having an additional charge compared to other heals. However, it's a bit like using a Peppa Pig Band-Aid after being hit by a missile, as it's unlikely to have much of an impact when you've been deathstruck. You know what would have an impact? Subscribing. Oh, and hitting that little bell thingy or whatever. You can mitigate this weakness by teaming up with a destroyer who lay a smokescreen for you, as Colbert's low caliber guns have pretty much non-existent smoke throwing penalties. However, to do this you'd have to actually have friends, so I've yet to try the effectiveness of this strategy. As I said at the start of the video, Colbert quickly became one of my favourite ships to play. Whilst it can be difficult to get into the right situations to apply her redonkulous DPM without being annihilated, when you do manage to utilise this ship to her full potential, I don't think there's anything quite as satisfying in the game other than blind firing a Smolensk in a smokescreen. She's definitely not easy to play, and in your first few games you will get curb stomped, but she's so much fun and I highly recommend you pick her up in the Research Bureau, where she's available for just 57,000 points. Reject Ohio, embrace Colbert memory. I will not be embracing her for any longer though, as this ship was very kindly provided to me as a rental for me to review by Wargaming. Rest assured, she's priority target number one in the Research Bureau for me now. I'll have you again soon. She's an interesting one to place on the tier list, as she's certainly not ridiculously powerful or even, to be frank, a smart choice if you intend on carrying games. She relies on a decent team to spot for her and take fire for her to some extent. With all this taken into consideration, I'm going to place her into high tier, if not just for the fun factor alone. She's incredibly powerful in the right hands, and you'll have just an absolute blast if you know what you're doing. The learning curve is absolutely worth it. Go pick her up. She's a lot of fun. If you'd like a captain build and equipment loader for the ship, go for something like this. This is taken from the amazing World of Warships Captain Guide Google Doc, which is a fantastic resource for all your ship build needs. I'll put a link to it down in the description. As always, please like and subscribe if you enjoyed. It's cliche, but it really does help reach the boost of my videos, and I really appreciate it. 1,000 subscribers draws ever closer, and I'm incredibly thankful for the support, as always. Let me know in the comments what ship you'd like to see next. Now go out there, and let it burn.
Now watch this drive.